The abutments of this bridge on the Washington County Railroad, Connecticut River Division, might seem quite odd. There's new concrete over old stuff, and, well, there's also these sections that are sticking out. Well, this side is certainly the most obvious, with it hanging several feet out over the abutment below. There's something less obvious on this side, which might help you get an understanding of what its purpose is. The top section of these abutments was replaced due to their deteriorating condition, which even lower down is not that good. Though, given the spread footing and that only the face is deteriorating, the concrete inside of it is still sound, it's sufficient to hold the railway traffic. That interior concrete is typical of several bridge abutments I've seen constructed about this time. This was built in 1912. That is, no rebar and some large round aggregate. Some of the stones in here were up to a foot in diameter, which resulted in this being some of the toughest concrete to cut through the people with the wire saw who were cutting it had ever experienced. The concrete had deteriorated to such a degree that one of the bearings that the girders for this bridge had been sitting on had a visible gap below it, but the bridge was still seeing active train traffic. That is because there were timber pile supports driven into the riverbed under these girders holding them up. Those supports, which I assume were intended as a temporary measure, had been there at least 20 years when this work was done in the fall of 2021. They were not in the best of conditions, to put it mildly, with portions of them rotting away, though there was enough sound wood that they were able to support the freight trains that were passing over this bridge. It was only the abutments on this bridge that had issues. The superstructure is still in pretty good condition. No salt near it. So, how do you replace the abutments on a bridge without replacing the entire bridge? That's where these areas that jut out, and they exist on both sides of this bridge, come into play. This bridge is light enough, I believe there are fairly mobile cranes that could lift the entire thing up and just move it out of the way. However, those cranes aren't cheap, and the silty riverbank soils around here and floodplain, not sure it could really support those cranes without either significant fill into wetlands or other stabilization measures. The railroad bed is only so wide that's well stabilized. That gets us back to these pieces jutting out of the lowest portion of the abutment. These were built and heavily reinforced to allow for a beam to be put between the two of them across the top under the bridge, and then with blocking to support the stringers, the beam and the bridge was jacked up from these in so that the bridge could be lifted up enough that the central portion of the abutment could be cut out and a new abutment poured in its place during a short 4-day railroad shutdown. These concrete blocks, which currently have no purpose and might be hard to figure out what the purpose is, were vital in rebuilding this structure. In engineering, it's not just the final product that you're designing for, but also how you build it. And sometimes that can be the hardest part. This had been a timber bridge, just a couple hundred feet south of the other bridge I was looking at. However, in 2005, when a train was passing over it, the driver heard some strange sounding noises, so asked the track maintenance people to take a look. What they found was the stringers had broken, which caused an immediate shutdown of the rail. In the rush to repair it, they had insufficient large culverts on hand. The railroad did have some tanker cars that were damaged to a degree they were non-functional, so the ends were cut off them, and they were installed as culverts. Three of them in this location, and either at the same time if they had them, or I would suspect sometime later, they installed two more CMP culverts on the ends to allow for more flow through this area. Another aspect of construction, and particularly in emergency response, is what do you have on hand? It's an important consideration when, if let's say you want to spec a 8-foot pipe, but because 5-foot pipe are much more available in kind of standard stock, that maybe is the only thing you can get at kind of in the next day or two. So that's what you end up putting in, even if a larger pipe would be better. And they may or may not get replaced as a long-term repair, depending how important it is or how much effort you want to put into it.
Now that's some deteriorated concrete.